Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. The Starfish and the Spider. The unstoppable power of leaderless organizations. By Ori Brafman and Rod A. Beckstrom. Narrated by Lloyd James. Introduction. It was like a game of Where's Waldo? But instead of kids playing the game, the players were the world's leading neuroscientists. And instead of Waldo, they were looking for a curly-haired, sweater-wearing grandma. Anyone's grandma. The neuroscientists were trying to answer what at first appeared to be a simple question. We all have memories, whether of our first day at school or of our grandmother. But where, the scientists asked, do these memories reside? Little did they know that they were about to arrive at a conclusion that would have surprising implications, not only for biology, but also for every industry in the world, for international terrorism, and for a host of far-flung communities. Scientists had long assumed that our brains, like other complex machines, had a top-down structure. Surely, in order to store and manage a lifetime of memories, our brains needed a chain of command. The hippocampus is in charge, and neurons which store specific memories report up to it. When we recall a memory, our hippocampus, acting like a high-speed computer, retrieves it from a specific neuron. Want to access a memory of your first love? Go to neuron number 18,416. Want to access a memory of your fourth-grade teacher? Go to neuron number 46,124,394. In order to prove this theory, the scientists needed to show that certain neurons are activated when we attempt to retrieve a particular memory. Beginning in the 1960s, scientists wired up subjects with electrodes and sensors and showed them pictures of familiar objects. The hope was that each time a subject was presented with a picture, a specific neuron would be triggered. Subjects spent hours staring at photographs. The scientists watched and waited for specific neurons to fire. And they waited, and they waited. Instead of a neat correlation between particular memories and particular neurons, they found a mess. Each time subjects were presented with a picture, many different neurons lit up. What's more, sometimes the same group of neurons would light up in response to more than one picture. At first, the scientists figured that it was a technological problem. Maybe the sensors weren't precise enough. For decades afterward, neuroscientists conducted variations on this experiment. Their equipment became more sensitive. But still, they produced no meaningful results. What was going on? Surely memories had to reside somewhere in the brain. An MIT scientist by the name of Jerry Letvin proposed a solution. The notion that a given memory lies within one cell was just plain wrong. As much as scientists wanted to find hierarchy in the brain, Letvin argued, it just wasn't there. Letvin's theory was that rather than being housed in particular neurons that report to the hippocampus, memory is distributed across various parts of the brain. He coined the term grandmother cell to represent the mythical neuron that houses the memory of grandma. The picture Letvin painted of the brain at first appears primitive and disorganized. Why would such a complex thinking machine evolve in such an odd way? Counterintuitive as it may be, this distributed structure actually makes the brain more resilient. Let's say, for example, we wanted to erase a certain memory from someone's brain. Under the hierarchical model, we'd locate the specific neuron and zap it, and the memory would be gone. But in Letvin's model, the memory would be much more difficult to eliminate. We'd have to zap a pattern of neurons, a much more difficult proposition. Like neuroscientists searching for the grandma cell, when we look at the world outside of our brain, we naturally seek order. We look for hierarchy all around us, whether we're looking at a Fortune 500 company, an army, or a community. Our natural reaction is to ask, who's in charge? This book is about what happens when there's no one in charge. It's about what happens when there's no hierarchy. You'd think there would be disorder, even chaos. But in many arenas, a lack of traditional leadership is giving rise to powerful groups that are turning industry and society upside down. In short, there's a revolution raging all around us. No one suspected that Sean Fanning, sitting in his dorm room in Northeastern University in 1999, was about to change the world. The 18-year-old freshman typed at his computer and wondered what would happen if people could share music files with one another. Fanning came up with Napster, an idea that would deliver a crushing blow to the recording industry. But he wasn't at the head of this attack. The entire battle was waged by an army of music-sharing teens, college students, and eventually, iPod-carrying businessmen. Half a world away, when Osama bin Laden left Saudi Arabia and traveled to Afghanistan, hardly anyone realized that in just a few years, he would become the most wanted man in the world. At the time, his power appeared limited. After all, what could a man operating out of a cave really do? But Al-Qaeda became powerful because bin Laden never took a traditional leadership role. In 1995, a shy engineer posted online listings of upcoming events in the San Francisco Bay Area. Craig Newmark never dreamed that the site he launched would forever alter the newspaper industry. In 2001, a retired options trader set out to provide free reference materials to kids around the world. He never thought that his efforts would one day allow millions of strangers to use something called a wiki to create the biggest information depository of our time. The blows to the recording industry, the attacks of 9/11, and the success of online classifieds and a collaborative encyclopedia were all driven by the same hidden force. The harder you fight this force, the stronger it gets. The more chaotic it seems, the more resilient it is. The more you try to control it, the more unpredictable it becomes. Decentralization has been lying dormant for thousands of years. But the advent of the internet has unleashed this force, knocking down traditional businesses, altering entire industries, affecting how we relate to each other, and influencing world politics. The absence of structure, leadership, and formal organization, once considered a weakness, has become a major asset. Seemingly chaotic groups have challenged and defeated established institutions. The rules of the game have changed. This would become strikingly clear on the steps of the U.S. Supreme Court, where a high-profile case was about to become surprisingly weird. Chapter 1, MGM's Mistake and the Apache Mystery. Don Verrilli might as well have uncorked the champagne bottle right then and there on the marble steps of the Supreme Court. The case he was about to argue was a slam dunk. It was late March 2005, and Verrilli must have felt like he was on top of the world. Verrilli is the kind of lawyer you want on your side. He was the editor-in-chief of the prestigious Columbia Law Review. He clerked for Justice William Brennan, and he regularly wins big cases in front of the Supreme Court. The man is one serious overachiever. If Verrilli is like Babe Ruth, he was joined by an all-star legal team that resembled the 1927 New York Yankees. It included heavy hitters Ken Starr, of Clinton impeachment and Monica Lewinsky fame, and David Kendall, who defended Clinton during said impeachment. You wouldn't want to be playing against this lineup. Verrilli and crew were the hired guns of MGM, the huge entertainment company. MGM, in turn, was joined in the suit by giants like Columbia, Disney, Warner Brothers, Atlantic Records, Capitol Records, RCA, BMG, Sony, and Virgin Records. You get the idea. The biggest players, with the best lawyers in the world, arguing before the highest court in the land. And what were these giants fighting? Grokster, a tiny company that most of us have never even heard of. Grokster is referred to as a P2P, peer-to-peer service. It allows people to steal, share, music and movie files over the internet. Given how easy the service was to use, and given that it was completely free, people from all over the world had been happily sharing everything, from the latest Britney Spears album to the hottest unofficial movie releases. In fact, Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, appeared online on peer-to-peer networks for free the same day it was released in movie theaters. The only catch was that none of this content was licensed. Grokster's users were basically stealing music. And we're not just talking about a few hackers sitting in the dark basements of university computer science departments. We're talking about average Joe living down the block. In fact, if you ask any 18 to 24-year-old with access to a computer, chances are they've used a service like Grokster. It's estimated that there were 8.63 million users of peer-to-peer services in the United States alone in April 2005. There hadn't been so much sharing by young people in America since the Summer of Love days in 1968. All this swapping was adding up to trouble for the film and recording industries. MGM and its fellow labels weren't in the business of letting music and film proliferate around the world. They were trying to make a profit. Music swapping was having a significant impact on the bottom line. Just how much? Verrilli would tell us soon. The counselor began his oral argument but was interrupted by Justice Breyer, who saw an elephant going to pieces over a tiny mouse. He asked, essentially, "What's the big deal?" "There is innovation," he said to Verrilli, "and there are problems in the music industry, but it thrives," and so forth. Verrilli saved his response for the very end of his oral argument. He knew that the elephant he was representing wasn't just being hysterical. It had good reason to be scared out of its wits. "Justice Breyer," Verrilli pleaded, "the facts are that we have lost, the recording industry has lost, 25% of its revenue since the onslaught of these services." 25%. That's something to get worked up about. The entire mess had started only 5 years before the Supreme Court case, when a no-name college freshman was too lazy to go to Tower Records. Lazy or arrogant, he wanted his music for free. 18-year-old Sean Fanning, nicknamed Napster by his friends, launched a company out of his dorm room. People used Napster by logging into a central server and sharing files with others around the world. Everyone loved the invention and started swapping files like there was no tomorrow. And sure enough, there wasn't much of a tomorrow for Napster. The labels quickly slapped Napster with a lawsuit. Unsurprisingly, groups like the ACLU protested that the suit was a free speech violation, but the courts didn't buy that argument. Nor did anyone pay much attention to the countless angry hackers out there, who, like children who just lost a schoolyard brawl, taunted, "We'll get you. It's just going to get worse for you." Indeed, on February 12, 2000, the courts ruled against Napster. In June 2003, Napster declared bankruptcy, and in December 2003, it sold its brand name and intellectual property to Roxio Incorporated for a song. All this legal wrangling was part of a larger strategy. Let's say the locksmith down the street is running an entire business centered on ripping you off. In the morning, as soon as you leave for work, the locksmith sneaks up the stairs to your house, breaks the lock, and props the door open. Everyone and his uncle barges in, checks out your silverware, your dishes, your jewelry, your new stereo, and walks out with them. A couple of burly guys even carry off your washing machine. You come home, and after the initial shock wears off, you want to go after both the burglars and the people who let them in. The record labels were faced with a similar problem. The peer-to-peer companies were enabling theft. The users were pirating music left and right. The industry came up with a two-pronged strategy. First, they went after the specific thieves, in this case, the people who were swapping the music. They tracked down those people who were downloading songs, the big offenders, and slapped them with a copyright infringement lawsuit, threatening to take them to court unless they settled and paid a $4,000 fine. This tactic was meant not only to deter file swappers from ever downloading a song again, but also to send a strong message to the rest of the world. We're serious about enforcing our intellectual property rights. If you break the law and steal our content, we'll go after you. Second, the labels attacked the root of the problem by going after the people who were picking the locks and enabling the theft. In this case, the peer-to-peer companies. The labels retained the best lawyers to sue those companies out of existence. Enter Verilli. As expected, the attorney performed flawlessly. It's not a big surprise that 2 months after his oral argument, the court handed down a unanimous decision in MGM's favor. But as the labels were repeatedly winning lawsuits against peer-to-peer companies, the overall problem of music piracy was getting worse and worse. It wasn't that the labels weren't vigilant enough. It was actually the opposite. The labels were adding fuel to the fire with every new lawsuit. The harder they fought, the stronger the opposition grew. Something weird was going on. The best explanation for the events comes from an unlikely source. Meet Tom Nevins, a cultural anthropologist specializing in Native American tribes of the Southwest. Although Nevins has never set foot inside a recording studio, his study of ancient tribes sheds light on what's happening today in the music industry. In many ways, he understands what's going on better than anyone else. We initially heard about Tom when we were leafing through the introduction he wrote to a book on the Apaches. Suddenly, we stopped. Wait a second, we thought. This guy is talking about Native Americans. But what he's saying could just as easily apply to the Grokster case. We tracked Nevins down in Iowa, where the young anthropologist was living with his wife and baby. At first, he was caught off guard. He said, I didn't think anyone even read that book. But as we talked to him, Nevins started drawing connections, putting what was happening in the world in a much larger context. It all starts with a mystery, an ancient mystery, and solving it provides the key to understanding where MGM went wrong. To uncover the solution, Nevins took us back in time almost 5 centuries to the year 1519, to the land known today as Mexico City, where one of the most famous explorers in history, the legendary Hernando Cortes, set eyes on the Aztec capital for the first time. The explorer was amazed by the great highways leading to the metropolis, then called Tenochtitlan, as well as by the complex aqueducts and the sheer size and beauty of the temples and pyramids. Cortes had expected to see savages, but instead he encountered a civilization with a population of more than 15 million, its own language, an advanced calendar, and a central government. The city, he marveled, was as large as Seville or Cordoba. And in the marketplace, over 60,000 souls gathered to buy and sell, and one can behold every possible kind of merchandise found in lands the world over. But Cortes didn't go to Tenochtitlan to sightsee. Like the CEOs of the record labels, Cortes was there to get rich. The way to get rich at that time was to get your hands on gold. And so one of the first things Cortes did was to speak with the Aztec leader, Montezuma II. He entered Montezuma's Grand Palace, which was big enough to house the entire Spanish army. The conversation he had can be summed up as follows. Give me all your gold, or I'll kill you. Montezuma didn't quite know what to do with the explorer. He'd never seen someone like him before, and on the off chance that Cortes was a deity, Montezuma yielded and handed over all of his gold. But just as no one has ever called Cortes a tourist, no one has ever called him a man of his word. Despite his promise, Cortez killed Montezuma. Chaos ensued. Cortez and his army surrounded Tenochtitlan. They barricaded the roads, preventing any food from entering the city, and they blocked off the aqueducts. Within 80 days, 240,000 inhabitants of the city starved to death. By 1521, just 2 years after Cortez first laid eyes on Tenochtitlan, the entire Aztec Empire, a civilization that traced its roots to centuries before the time of Christ, had collapsed. The Aztecs weren't alone. A similar fate befell the Incas. The Spanish army, led by Francisco Pizarro, captured the Inca leader Atahualpa in 1532. A year later, with all the Incan gold in hand, the Spanish executed Atahualpa and appointed a puppet ruler. Again, the annihilation of an entire society took only 2 years. These monumental events eventually gave the Spanish control of the continent. By the 1680s, the Spanish forces seemed unstoppable. With the winds of victory at their backs, they headed north and encountered the Apaches. This meeting in the deserts of present-day New Mexico is crucially linked with the music industry's fight against the peer-to-peer sites. Why? Because the Spanish lost. They lost to a people who at first seemed primitive. Unlike the Aztecs and the Incas, the Apaches hadn't put up a single pyramid, paved a single highway, or even built a town to speak of. More important for the conquistadors than pyramids or highways, the Apaches also had no gold. So instead of pillaging, the Spanish tried to turn these people into Catholic farmers by forcing them to adopt an agrarian lifestyle and converting them to Christianity. Some of the Apaches did, in fact, take up rake and hoe, but the vast majority resisted. Not only did they resist, but they actively fought back, raiding everything in sight that was remotely Spanish. You'd think that against an army like the Spanish, the Apaches wouldn't have had a chance. But that wasn't the case. As Nevins told us, by the late 17th century, the Spanish had lost effective control of northern Sonora and Chihuahua to the Apaches. The Apaches had successfully wrested control of North Mexico, not that it was ever their desire to do so. This wasn't a single accidental victory, however. The Apaches continued to hold off the Spanish for another 2 centuries. It wasn't that the Apaches had some secret weapon that was unknown to the Incas and the Aztecs, nor that the Spanish army lost its might. No, the Apache defeat of the Spanish was all about the way the Apaches were organized as a society. The Spanish couldn't defeat them for the same reason that the record labels weren't able to squash the peer-to-peer trend. Nevins told us how he arrived at the solution to the mystery. A few years ago, he spent 3 years living with the White Mountain Apaches in Arizona, studying their culture, observing their rituals, and learning how their society really works. He immediately recognized differences between the Apaches and other tribes. If you look, for example, at the Sioux, the Dances with Wolves people, right? They have some degree of political centralization. They resisted spectacularly for short periods of time, but they were really not successful for more than 10 years. Whereas the Apaches were fighting this battle for hundreds of years. How did they survive? They distributed political power and had very little centralization. The Apaches persevered because they were decentralized. To understand the implications of what Nevins says, let's take a quick look at two opposite systems, centralized and decentralized. A centralized organization is easy to understand. Think of any major company or governmental agency. You have a clear leader who's in charge, and there's a specific place where decisions are made. The boardroom, the corporate headquarters, city hall. Nevins calls this organizational type coercive, because the leaders call the shots. When a CEO fires you, you're out. When Cortez ordered his army to march, they marched. The Spanish, Aztecs, and Incas were all centralized, or coercive. Although it sounds like something out of a Russian gulag, a coercive system is not necessarily bad. Whether you're a Spanish general, an Aztec leader, or a CEO of a Fortune 500 company, you use command and control to keep order in your organization, to make it efficient, and to function from day to day. Rules need to be set and enforced, or the system collapses. For instance, when you get on an airplane, you had better hope it's a coercive system. You certainly don't want Johnson from seat 29J to decide that right about now is a good time to land. No, Johnson needs to sit quietly and enjoy the movie while the captain, and only the captain, has the authority to make decisions to ensure that the plane flies properly. Decentralized systems, on the other hand, are a little trickier to understand. In a decentralized organization, there's no clear leader, no hierarchy, and no headquarters. If and when a leader does emerge, that person has little power over others. The best that person can do to influence people is to lead by example. Nevins calls this an open system, because everyone is entitled to make his or her own decisions. This doesn't mean that a decentralized system is the same as anarchy. There are rules and norms, but these aren't enforced by any one person. Rather, the power is distributed among all the people and across geographic regions. Basically, there's no Tenochtitlan and no Montezuma. But without a Montezuma, how do you lead? Instead of a chief, the Apaches had a Nantan, a spiritual and cultural leader. The Nantan led by example and held no coercive power. Tribe members followed the Nantan because they wanted to, not because they had to. One of the most famous Nantans in history was Geronimo, who defended his people against the American forces for decades. Geronimo never commanded an army. Rather, he himself started fighting, and everyone around him joined in. The idea was, if Geronimo is taking arms, maybe it's a good idea. Geronimo's been right in the past, so it makes sense to fight alongside him. You wanted to follow Geronimo? You followed Geronimo. You didn't want to follow him? Then you didn't. The power lay with each individual. You were free to do what you wanted. The phrase, you should, doesn't even exist in the Apache language. Coercion is a foreign concept. The Nantans were crucial to the well-being of this open system, but decentralization affects more than just leadership. Because there was no capital and no central command post, the Apache decisions were made all over the place. A raid on a Spanish settlement, for example, could be conceived in one place, organized in another, and carried out in yet another. You never knew where the Apaches would be coming from. In one sense, there was no place where important decisions were made, and in another sense, decisions were made by everybody, everywhere. On first impression, it may sound like the Apaches were loosey-goosey and disorganized. In reality, however, they were an advanced and sophisticated society. It's just that a decentralized organization is a completely different creature. Nevins explained that the traits of a decentralized society, flexibility, shared power, ambiguity, made the Apaches immune to attacks that would have destroyed a centralized society. Let's see what happens when a coercive system takes on an open society. The Spanish, a centralized body, had been used to seeing everything through the lens of a centralized or coercive system. When they encountered the Apaches, they went with the tactics that had worked in the past, the take the gold and kill the leader strategy, and started eliminating Nantans. But as soon as they killed one off, a new Nantan would emerge. The strategy failed because no one person was essential to the overall well-being of Apache society. Not only did the Apaches survive the Spanish attacks, but amazingly, the attacks served to make them even stronger. When the Spanish attacked them, the Apaches became even more decentralized and even more difficult to conquer. When the Spanish destroyed their villages, the Apaches might have surrendered if the villages had been crucial to their society, but they weren't. Instead, the Apaches abandoned their old houses and became nomads. Try to catch us now. This is the first major principle of decentralization. When attacked, A decentralized organization tends to become even more open and decentralized. Back in our 21st century reenactment of the conflict, the music labels took on the role of the Spanish. The part of the Aztecs was played by peer-to-peer companies like Grokster and Napster. The labels slapped on lawsuits and brought in modern-day conquistadors like Virilli. As we saw, these tactics worked, and Napster went out of business. The labels defeated Napster because it was more centralized than not. The company had a Tenochtitlan, central servers that users had to log into, and a Montezuma, a hierarchical structure with a CEO. In other words, although Napster was more open and decentralized than the labels, it allowed users to swap music for free with other users, it wasn't decentralized and flexible enough to withstand attacks by the centralized giants. By crippling the Tenochtitlan, Napster's central server, and going after Montezuma, Napster's corporate management, the music labels prevailed. But Napster's destruction didn't quell people's desire for free music. Imagine that you're a kid who's been drinking from the fountain of free downloaded music. All of a sudden, some guys in suits turn off the spigot and declare you a criminal. Sure, you can go back to the record store, a place you haven't seen for months, and shell out 3 hours' salary for a CD. A more attractive option, however, is to find a Napster equivalent. Along came Niklas Zennström, a Swedish engineer who wanted to make it big by feeding the hungry. The hungry song swappers, that is. Zennström was no Apache non-ton, but he realized that in order to survive, he had better avoid Napster's mistakes. His solution was a new program called Kazaa. With Kazaa, there's no central server, no Tenochtitlan. John in California could directly access Denise's computer in Nebraska for that brand new U2 song, or Jerry's computer in San Francisco for that favorite Beatles tune. Within 12 months, more than 250 million copies of Kazaa had been downloaded. The avalanche of music swapping was massive. Kazaa gave power to the users without the need for a central server. Compare Kazaa to the record labels. The record labels have offices, distribution channels, marketing departments, and high-paid executives. Because they have exclusive content, they can charge users a premium. And no, you can't copy a CD and give it to your friends. Kazaa, on the other hand, is like an Apache village. There are no headquarters, no big salaries, and if you want to make 1,000 copies of your favorite song, by all means, go right ahead. But in order to have a business, you need a Montezuma, right? Zennström, wanting to stay off the label's radar, was at best a reluctant Montezuma. He built pyramids only when he thought the labels weren't looking, and he paved roads only in places where the labels didn't have much access. His revenue came from selling ad space on Kazaa, a centralized feature that proved to be a weakness. Zennström was so wary of companies like MGM, in fact, that he and his partner eluded men on motorcycles, representatives of the record labels, who tried to serve them with subpoenas. When the labels, acting like the Spanish, finally succeeded in suing Kazaa and its users, Zennström sold the Dutch parent company to an outfit based on the South Pacific island of Vanuatu, far beyond the reach of the American and European legal systems. Just like the Apaches, who had no choice but to become nomadic, Zennström had to decentralize to survive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.